See, the Virgin is delivered in a cold and crowded sky. Mirror of the Father's glory lies beside her in the straw. He is mercy's incarnation. Marvel at this miracle. For the Virgin gently holds a glorious impossible. Love has come to walk on water, turn the water into wine. Touch the leper, bless the children, love both human and divine. Praise the wisdom of the Father, who has spoken through His Son. Speaking still, He calls us to the glorious impossible. Hallelujah, 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 glorious impossible. He was bruised for our transgressions, and He bears eternal scars. He was raised for our salvation, and His righteousness is ours. Praise, oh praise Him, praise the glory of this lavish grace so full. Lift your souls now and receive the glorious impossible. Hallelujah, 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 glorious impossible. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Glorious impossible. Praise, oh praise Him, praise the glory of this lavish grace so full. Lift your souls now and receive the glorious impossible.
Good morning and welcome to Madison Church of Christ. I hope you guys had a Merry Christmas. If you're like me, you may still have a couple Christmases left to go. I pray those are merry as well. I'm glad that we get to be here together, worshiping the Savior that was born on Christmas here in this room. I want to share a couple announcements with you. One is in your bulletin that there will be a board meeting after the church, and that's not one of our regular scheduled meetings, so that'll be under the balcony after the service. And then I want to tell you about this sheet of paper that's in both foyers. Each year we try to have a Bible reading plan, and if you've been reading along with us in 2021, we read the whole Bible in a year, which works out to about 24 chapters. That's a lot of Bible, and we're going to slow it down a little bit for 2022. We're just going to read the New Testament and Psalms together. It works out to less than 8 chapters a week, and it doesn't divide out exactly that way because it's divided by word count, so you get roughly the same amount of reading each week. But I just really invite you to consider doing this with us. It is a great way to start reading your Bible. If maybe it's something you haven't done before or something that you haven't done in a while, you can read just a chapter a day. And it's really is a doable pace and something that we can do together as a church there. Each week you'll find the Bible reading plan on the back of the bulletin, and then you have this sheet here. They'll break it down for you. It's available on our website, and you can read a little bit more about our Bible reading plan in our messenger for the month of January that is also out in each foyer. So grab one of these on your way out. Think about reading your Bible together with us this year. Now we're going to go to a time of prayer.
It was a bittersweet day yesterday. A great time with family and friends. But we lost a good brother in Dave DeVilder. We know Margie's still dealing with COVID. And others are as well. And we know that Diane Siemens has entered hospice. I want you to close your eyes. I want you to hear the words from Isaiah 25, and then I will pray. Oh Lord, you are my God. I will exalt you, I will praise your name. For you have done wonderful things, plans formed of old, faithful and sure. For you have made the city a heap, the fortified city a ruin, the foreigner's palace is a city no more, it will never be rebuilt. Therefore strong peoples will glorify you, cities of ruthless nations will fear you. For you have been a stronghold to the poor, a stronghold to the needy in his distress, a shelter from the storm and a shade from the heat. For the breath of the ruthless is like a storm against the wall, like heat in a dry place. You subdue the noise of the foreigners as heat by the shade of a cloud. So the song of the ruthless is put now. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food. A feast of well-aged wine, of rich food full of marrow, of aged wine well refined. And he will swallow up on this mountain the covering that is cast over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. And the Lord God will wipe away tears from all faces. And the reproach of his people he will take away from the earth. For the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, behold, this is our God. We have waited for him that he might save us. This is the Lord. We have waited for him. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. Father, we are brokenhearted today. And we know that you are near to those who are. And we pray for that this morning. God, we also take hope in the resurrection and eternal life through your Son, that one day our tears will be wiped away and death will be no more. God, even as we're dealing with just the realities of life and death today, help us to rest in your goodness and your peace. And just comfort our hearts this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's stand and praise the Lord this morning.
Today, as we prepare for communion, I want to tell you a story and pray using only lines and phrases from familiar Christmas songs. Prince of glory, gracing heaven ere time began. Long lay the world in sin and error pining. And ye, beneath life's crushing load, whose forms are bending low, who toil along the climbing way with painful steps and slow. O come, Emmanuel. Come, thou long expected Jesus. It came upon a midnight clear. Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Born to set thy people free. God with man is now residing. Yonder shines the infant light. Radiant beams from thy holy face with the dawn of redeeming grace. Word of the Father, now in flesh appearing. Veiled in flesh, the Godhead see. Hail the incarnate deity. O come, let us adore him. O come, let us adore him. O come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Truly, he taught us to love one another. His law is love and his gospel is peace. Chains shall he break, for the slave is our brother, and in his name all oppression shall cease. Mild he lays his glory by, born that man no more may die. Now for us embracing death as Son of Man. Bethlehem's incarnation, Calvary's bitter cross, wrought for us salvation by your pain and loss. And with his blood, mankind hath bought. God and sinners reconciled. And wonders of his love, and wonders of his love, and wonders, wonders of his love. Now ye need not fear the grave. Peace, peace. He has opened heaven's door, and man is blessed evermore. Now we fall before you in this holy place. By your cross, most holy, Lord, we worship you. Prostrate, we adore you for your gift of grace. Gloria in excelsis Deo. Born to raise the sons of earth, born to give them second birth. Where meek souls will receive him still, the dear Christ enters in. So God imparts to human hearts the blessings of his heaven. Cast out our sin and enter in. Be born in us today. The King of Kings salvation brings. Let loving hearts enthrone him. From our fears and sins release us. Let us find our rest in thee. By thine own eternal spirit, rule in all our hearts alone. O come to us, abide with us, our Lord Emmanuel. Amen.
peace arrived at Christmas. And we have been looking at the role that this word, that this theme plays in Luke's account of the Christmas story. Peace appears at the beginning and then at the middle and at the end. Zechariah's song of the path of peace opened up to God's people right at the beginning of Luke's Christmas account. At the crescendo of the Christmas story, when the angels are proclaiming the good news to the shepherds, they proclaim peace, or rather, on earth, peace to those on whom God's favor rests. And when the baby Jesus was presented in the temple to Simeon, he knew that Jesus, our Savior, had fulfilled all of God's promises, and he said, "You may now dismiss your servant in peace." I hope that you know the peace of Christmas. I hope that you felt it this weekend with your family. The peace that arrived on Christmas is the peace of knowing and trusting that Jesus, the baby born in Bethlehem, solves our biggest problems and our greatest questions. The problem of sin is solved by his blood. The problem of death is solved by his resurrection. The question of how much we mean to God is answered by his arrival. The question of what we can do to please God is answered by his words. The question of where we will go when we die was also answered with his words, and then those answers were ratified on Easter. Those truths give us the deepest peace available. They have the power to quiet the deepest anxieties in our soul. But some questions remain to be answered about peace. There are two that I hope to address today. First, why doesn't the world have peace? If it arrived on Christmas, then where can we find it? Why isn't it here? And second, why don't you and I always feel at peace? So why doesn't the world have peace? It arrived at Christmas over 2,000 years ago, but is our world one of peace? It's not, right? Why not? Consider the words of Jesus himself for a moment. The bringer of peace, the one heralded by the gospel writer Luke as the one who brought peace. Look what Jesus himself says in Luke 12. It's not very peaceful. In Luke 12:49, Jesus says, "I have come to bring fire on the earth, and how I wish that it were already kindled. But I have a baptism to undergo, and what constraint I am under until it's completed. Do you think I came to bring peace on the earth? No, I tell you, but division. From now on, there will be five in one family divided against each other, three against two, and two against three. They will be divided, father against son, and son against father, mother against daughter, and daughter, and daughter against mother, mother-in-law against daughter-in-law, and daughter-in-law against mother-in-law." That doesn't sound very peaceful at all, does it? Maybe we were wrong about Christmas. Except we weren't. Jesus did bring peace. Even though right here, he himself says that he didn't come to bring it, he did. I want you to think about or to look at the kind of peace that is characterized by Jesus after his resurrection. In Luke's account of the resurrection, Jesus comes to the disciples and says, "Peace be with you." And in your bulletin this morning, I've included passages from the end of John, where three times in quick succession, Jesus tells his disciples, "Peace be with you." It's not just a greeting, at least in the middle one, because Jesus has already said it, but he wants them to understand that he has achieved peace. Look what Peter says about Jesus in Acts chapter 10 when he's testifying to the household of Cornelius. Peter says, "You know the message of God sent to the people of Israel, announcing the good news of peace through Jesus Christ, who is Lord of all." So how can these both be true? How can we have a Savior who was announced with this great story of peace, the Christmas story, and a Savior who proclaims peace after he raises from the dead, a Savior who is testified to by his disciples as the one who brought peace, the good news of peace, but also a Savior who says that he didn't come to bring peace, but division. Here's the crucial truth that you must know to solve this dilemma. Jesus brought peace as our conquering king, and his conquest is still in process. Jesus brings peace to the world by overcoming the darkness of our world, the elements within it that disturb our peace. And that battle is not finished. It's still going. There is at this moment a battle raging in our world between the kingdom of peace ruled by Jesus Christ and the kingdom of the prince of our world. The forces of evil and sin and what the Bible will sometimes call our flesh. That battle, just as Jesus said, it divides people. Even people in the same household or family, because there can be no quarter given from either side of this battle. As the Bible said, what fellowship is there between light and darkness? Either Jesus is your king or he is not. His kingdom is peace. He is the king of peace. And outside of his kingdom, there is no peace. The same problems that have plagued mankind since the very beginning of the story of the Bible, their estrangement from God and the guilt of sin, still plague those who do not belong to his kingdom. We see this contrast here in Romans 2 between the two sides in this ongoing battle. I'm going to start reading in verse 5. Verse 9 is up on the screen. But because of your stubbornness and your unrepentant heart, you are storing up wrath against yourself for the day of God's wrath, when his righteous judgment will be revealed. God will repay each person according to what they have done. To those who by persistence in doing good seek glory, honor, and immortality, he will give eternal life. But there's another side. In verse 8 it says, but for those who are self-seeking and who reject the truth and follow evil, there will be wrath and anger. There will be trouble and distress for every human being who does evil, first for the Jew, then for the Gentile. But glory, honor, and peace for everyone who does good. Do you see the battle lines there? Do you see the size of this conquest that is at work in our world? The invading kingdom of Jesus Christ, our King of Peace, at work against the forces that had, previous to his coming, reigned. This is why our world does not have peace. Because Jesus' conquest is not finished. And many remain who do not belong to his kingdom of peace. We see that contrast further in Romans 8. We read there, those who live according to the flesh have their minds set on what the flesh desires, but those who live in accordance with the Spirit have their mind set on what the Spirit desires. The mind governed by the flesh is death. But the mind governed by the Spirit is life and peace. The mind governed by the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. Those who are in the realm of flesh cannot please God. So there are two sides, and there are people who belong to Christ's kingdom, and there are people who don't. That is the reason why our world doesn't have peace. That is an indicator that Christ's conquest isn't finished as he's promised us that one day it will be. But this battle is deeper than an interpersonal struggle. It's more complex than just good guys and bad guys. It's more than an in or out story for Christ's kingdom. What we learn in God's word is that the battle between Christ's kingdom of peace and the world and the flesh's kingdom of evil and sin is one that we are fighting within our own soul. It's not about other people or just which side of the line you stand on, but it is a battle going on in your own heart and in your own mind. It's a battle you begin fighting when you become a Christian, not a battle that you're done fighting when you become a Christian. And you will not be done fighting this battle in your heart and in your soul until you breathe your last breath. The same chapter that we just read from, Romans chapter 8, goes on to talk about those who do have the Spirit of God, those who do have Christ as their king. It tells us this starting in verse 12. Therefore, brothers and sisters, we have an obligation, but it is not to the flesh to live according to it. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the misdeeds of the body, you will live. You see, we are waging a war in our own hearts, in our own lives, between two competing factions, between the Savior who we have accepted as Lord, the Holy Spirit of God which dwells inside of us, and the darkness and evil of our flesh and our corrupted being, our corrupted world. We have to wage a war in our own soul to put the part of us that does not belong to Christ's kingdom of peace to death. That's the war we're fighting. There's a passage about this struggle in James chapter 4 that I want to share with you, starting in verse 1. We're hopping around a lot today. We have two more passages. James chapter 1 will be there for a while if you want to turn there. James chapter 4, starting in verse 1. We read this in James 4, starting in verse 1. It says, "What causes fights and quarrels among you? Don't they come from your desires that battle within you? You desire, but you do not have, so you kill. You covet, but you cannot get what you want, so you quarrel and fight. You do not have because you do not ask God. And when you ask, you do not receive because you ask with wrong motives, that you may spend what you get on your pleasures." It's a paragraph saying, you don't have peace, do you? Say, I know you guys don't have peace. There are quarrels. There's not peace between each other. There's not even peace within yourself. You desire, but you don't have. You do not have because you do not ask. He's saying, you're not at peace, and I know you're not at peace. So he says in verse 4, "You adulterous people." In Greek, it's just one word, moikiletes, prostitutes, it says. "Don't you know that friendship with the world means enmity against God? Therefore, anyone who chooses to be a friend of the world becomes an enemy of God. Or do you think that Scripture says without reason that he jealously longs for the Spirit he has caused to dwell in us? But he gives us more grace. That is why Scripture says God opposes the proud, but shows favor to the humble." And it says, "Submit yourselves then to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Come near to God, and he will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Grieve, mourn, and wail. Change your laughter to mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will lift you up." Okay, the invitation to this passage is to recognize the battle that's going on within your soul and within your life, and to recognize that the world is at enmity with Christ's kingdom of peace. The world is at enmity with the Spirit of God that dwells inside of you, and they are not friends. So the remedy is to submit yourselves to God, to resist the devil. And yes, Jesus brought peace. Peace arrived at Christmas, but is a peace that conquers the power of sin and death in our world. And if we are still, personally, if you are still embracing the world, the sinful desires of your flesh, embracing the way the world thinks, the way the world covets, the way the world worries, we are surrendering in that battle, and we will not experience peace because Jesus Christ wins our peace through conquering those things. And if we embrace them, then they will stay with us, and they will plague us, and they will ruin our peace. So James tells us to fight that battle in our soul. One more time, he says, "Submit yourselves then to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Come near to God, and he will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Grieve, mourn, and wail. Change your laughter to mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will lift you up." The reason why you don't always feel peace, even though it arrived at Christmas, is because the battle between Christ's kingdom of peace and the power of our sinful flesh is one we lose from time to time. When we let lust or greed or envy or resentment occupy our mind, we lose this battle and we forfeit our peace. When we let sadness of the circumstances of our life rule our mind, when we let those events and those occasions and those forces depress our spirit, we lose this battle and we forfeit our peace. I've been losing this battle a little lately. Maybe you have too. We've been through some incredibly hard times together this weekend. We've been through hard times together the last couple years. And it is easy to lose this battle. It is easy to let the things that we're going through in life, the losses that we suffer, the tragedies that occur, the struggles that we have, to win over God's Spirit in our hearts. To win over the peace that Jesus brought at Christmas, the peace that Jesus can give to your soul through His Spirit. We often look away from that and we lose this battle that's going on in our hearts and our souls. I know because I lose too. We have suffered loss, illness, storms. If not ourselves, then we have seen people that we love suffer these things. And even as I stand up here and tell you that Jesus brought peace on Christmas, I can lose the battle for peace in my own soul. It's hard. It's hard to keep that peace there when you're telling your friends or loved ones goodbye. It's harder to keep that peace there when you can't tell loved ones goodbye. Maybe you're like me and you've gone through times when you don't have a lot of peace. Or maybe you're going through a time right now when you don't feel at peace. Let me encourage you with this. The battle in your soul between the peace of Christ and the anxiety or sadness or temptations of the flesh is not one you always have to win. But it's one you've always got to fight. And God's Word tells us how to do that. God's Word doesn't require us to never lose a battle, or to never feel dejected, or to never not feel at peace. But it tells us how we can, through God's Spirit, find the peace that we have through Jesus and let that conquer what is bothering us. Let that conquer what is dragging us down and causing us to feel pain and no peace. I want to show you a passage where that is very clear, where the Bible speaks very clearly to how we can do that from Philippians. Chapter 4. We read there, "Rejoice in the Lord always. And I say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition and with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus." You see, you fight this battle in your mind by rejoicing in the Lord and casting off your anxiety in prayer. It's a battle you win with your thoughts if you point them in the right direction. We see this as we read on in verse 8, still in Philippians 4. It says, "Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things." Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. God's word tells us when we're going through these times and when we're losing this battle and when we need encouragement, when we need that peace that God's word tells us arrives on Christmas that we don't always feel, it says, point your mind in the right direction. Rejoice in the Lord. Cast your anxiety off to him in prayer and consider his goodness and the good things he has made. And the God of peace will be with you. A day is coming when the kingdom of peace, the kingdom of Jesus, will be completely victorious. Right now, our world doesn't have peace, and sometimes we don't have peace because Jesus' conquest is not yet finished. But God's word tells us that it will be one day. And when the battle of conquest I've described to you today, the battle that prevents peace in our world and in our soul, is over, we will not have to look for peace anymore. This morning, my challenge to you is to not give up fighting until that moment arrives. Don't give up fighting for peace. Don't give up pointing your mind in the right direction so that you can experience the peace that God will give you through his Spirit. Not even in the darkest or the hardest times when you're suffering the greatest. You'll have peace when you let Jesus conquer the wayward thoughts in your mind and the sinful desires in your flesh. Train your mind and heart to trust God, especially when it's hard. And confront the darkness of our world with the peace that arrived at Christmas through our King and Savior Jesus. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for the peace that comes through your Son. Thank you for the answer to these questions that trouble our soul, questions about who we are, about whether or not you care for us, about whether or not we will have life beyond the grave. To God, direct our minds and our hearts in the right direction so that when we're going through trials right now, we will see the glory of your kingdom. We will see the glory of what you have done through Jesus. And we will find reason for joy through your Spirit, which lives inside of us, as a deposit guaranteeing our future in heaven before your throne. Pray these things in your name. Amen.
Would you stand as we close today?